Israel, good morning to you. Shalom, shalom. Most High Christ bless. Most High Christ bless. How is everyone doing this morning? We're going to get started. We're going to send up the prayers. Face Jerusalem. Brothers, uncover your heads. Sisters, cover your heads. We're going to get started. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. How's everybody doing this morning? Hope all is well. I'm Officer Gabar, Iuic, Las Vegas. It's been a while since I've done class. I need a scribe. I need a scribe. I need a brother to scribe. Brother Adam. Oh, that was Layla Hathaway singing, and who was that? Robert Glasper on the keys. Yeah, Robert Glasper and Layla Hathaway. Well, Brother Adam, while you're asking about the music, are you going to scribe? Who's going to scribe? Shalom, Most High, grace blessed. Brother Josiah, how about you? Of course, Facebook has a devil on it. So the chats. Okay, all praises. Brother Adam, you scribing. All right. The title of the class is The Lord Will Revive Us. The Lord Will Revive Us. That is the title of the class. Let's go to start at Acts 20 and 28. Acts 20 and 28. It says, take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. So we have to take heed to ourselves, examine ourselves, especially as leaders of the people. And it says, over the which the Holy Ghost had made you overseers to feed the church of God. We have to feed the church of God with his word first, with the scriptures first. his laws, statutes, and commandments first, which he hath purchased with his own blood. The Christ died, gave up his life for the Israelites. The church are the Israelites. Right? So, again, the title of the class is The Lord Will Revive Us. What is the definition of revive? I'm going to ask you online. What does revive mean? Because I have the definition, but what does revive mean? All right, it's some good responses. Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. Let's look at the definition. Revive. Restore to life or consciousness. Restore to life or consciousness. That's correct. All those definitions are correct. Right? So, let's go to Genesis 2 and 7. Genesis 2 and 7. Wow. The state of being brought back from a dead situation. I like that one. Wow. But all those correct, but resurrect. Wow. Very good. Very good. Genesis 2 verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So, the Lord breathed life into his nostrils. The breath of life are the commandments. Let's go to Proverbs 7 and 2. Proverbs 7 and 2. Keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye. So he breathed into Adam's nostrils are the commandments, the laws. That's what makes you alive. Let's go to 2 Esdras chapter 3 and verse 5. Second Esdras, chapter 3, and verse 5. It says, and gavest a body unto Adam without soul, which was the workmanship of thine hands, and didst breathe into him the breath of life, and he was made a living soul. Was made living before thee. So without the commandments, we are dead. We are spiritually dead. While we have bodies, we walk, we talk, we see, we are spiritually dead as a people. Verse 6, And thou leddest him into paradise, which thy right hand had planted before ever the earth came forth. And unto him thou gavest commandment to love thy way. And unto him thou gavest commandment to love thy way. How do you love God? Let's go to 1 John 5 and 3. If I'm going too fast, let me know. First John 5 and 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. But to a lot of our people, including those that are in the truth, God's commandments are grievous. They are burdened. Some make it hard to do, to keep his commandments. So is it hard to get rid of shrimp, crab, lobster, pork? No. Is it hard to wear fringes? No. However, some, they make it a burden to wear fringes. I remember we were at camp, and we were teaching at camp, and we brought up fringes. And one brother we were teaching, he said, I can't wear fringes at work. So why not? Because they might see me. Well, isn't that the, well, I said, well, wait a minute. You wear a uniform at work? No, but they may see my fringes and start asking questions. What's wrong with that statement? What is wrong with that statement? They might see you, your fringes, and start asking questions. Here's one thing. Yes, we have to be harmless as a dove and wise as a serpent, right? So if they start asking questions, this is my custom. I like wearing them. What's so hard about that? But to this Jake, he says, somebody might see me. Well, isn't that the purpose? That our people will see it and start asking. Not at work, ooh, after work. But this Jake wanted to hide his fringes. 1 John 5 and 3 again, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. So, you know, if somebody must ask, it's my custom, and that's it. That's all that needs to be said. I like them. I like to wear them. That's it. But the scripture says, let our light shine before men, that they may see your good works. That they may see your good works. Back to 2 Edges 3. I'm sorry, I went off to 3 and 7. And unto him thou gavest commandment to love thy way, which he transgressed. And immediately thou appointest death in him and his generations, of whom came nations, tribes, people, and kindreds out of number. And every people walked after their own will and did wonderful things before thee and despised thy commandments. So, because the commandments were given to the Israelites, Some Israelites hate God's commandments. And as a result, here we are. Here we are. Let's see. Let's go to Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. I'll read that again. And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. What does that mean? Israel is my son, even my firstborn. What does that mean? Israel is my son, even my firstborn. I see one of the responses is the first nation chosen as a holy people. I'm going to, instead of the first nation chosen as a holy people, the only nation chosen as a holy people. The only nation chosen. And we are above all people, all nations on the earth. Let's get Deuteronomy 7 and 6. If you ha don't happen to know, God has favorites. Yes. I know Christianity has set up satellites in our people's head, but God has favorites. And he chose Israel to be his chosen, his favorite above all nations. Deuteronomy 7 and 6. For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. Holy means separate. Holy means separate. I'm going to go to Leviticus 20 and 26. Leviticus 20 and 26. And it says, And ye shall be holy unto me, for I the Lord am holy, and have severed you from other people. that ye should be mine. That ye should be mine. Severed. And he says, have severed you from other people. Severed means to separate. Separate. Severed. If you take something and you sever it, you cut it, you separate it from everything else. Let's go back to Deuteronomy 7:6. For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. So yes, God has favorites and we are his favorite. We are his favorite. He separated us from everybody else, all nations, and chose the Israelites. Now go to and tell your pastor that. Because that's what the Bible says. We're just reading the scriptures. And God said that we are special above all people that are upon the face of the earth. Let's go to Leviticus 26. Leviticus 26 and 14. Leviticus 26 and 14. But if ye will not hearken unto me, and will not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, also will do this unto you. I will also do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning ague that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. So the Lord set aside Israel and gave Israel the commandments, the law, statutes, and commandments, and say, if you disobey me, I'm gonna jack you up, I'm gonna punish you. And we jacked up, we disobeyed God, we disobeyed his commandments, and look at the condition we're in today as a nation of people. And by breaking the commandments, we became spiritually dead. Spiritually dead. And God punished us and still punishing us. He is still punishing us. Verse 17. And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you. I'm going to read that again. And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you. We were warned. God warned us. But you know what? A lot of our people are rebellious, don't want to hear it. He warned us, and yet, even to this day, a lot of our people are shocked by what's going on. Yeah, but the Lord had warned us. And we continually break his commandments. And we want to cleave to the enemies. We want to cleave unto the enemies. And in spite of God saying you're above all nations, that means you're not equal. These nations are not equal to you. You're better than them. And as a result, we are a dead people, spiritually and physically. And physically, but especially spiritually, we are dead. Hold this. I'm going to go to Nehemiah 9:37. Nehemiah 9:36. We're coming back to Leviticus, but we're in Nehemiah 9:36. Hold a minute, y'all. Okay, there we go. Nehemiah 9:36. Behold, we are servants this day, and for the land that thou gavest unto our fathers to eat the fruit thereof and the good thereof, behold, we are servants in it. Verse 37. And it yieldeth much increase unto the kings whom thou hast set over us because of our sins. Also, they have dominion over our bodies and over our cattle at their pleasure, and we are in great distress. And we are in great distress. Let's go back to Leviticus 26 and verse 17 again. Leviticus 26 and verse 17. And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. The Lord identified the enemies, who the enemies are. And yet, our people want to hold hands and march and protest with the enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you. Verse 18. And if ye will not for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. I will punish you seven times more for your sins. You know, a lot of times, in order to get our attention, the Lord has to turn up the heat. He has to turn up the heat. And that's what's going on right now. The Lord's turning up the heat. You know, there's so much oppression, death, murder and killing of our people that we don't even realize. We only notice to hear about the things that are publicized. We only hear about the events that are publicized, the crimes against our people. But what about those that aren't publicized? What about those? Verse 19, and I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass. That goes into, that's twofold. Almost threefold. And I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass. Your heaven as iron, meaning the Lord's not going to provide rain for our crops. And we will have yokes of iron around our neck. And sometimes those yokes of iron cover our whole head. And a lot of our people are in prison, locked up in prison. And the Lord loves us, and look what he's doing. Look at what he's doing. But he warned us. He did warn us. Let's go to Lamentation. Second chapter and the 13th verse. Lamentation 2:13. So what I'm going through scriptures of why we are in the state we are in today. Why are we in the conditions we are today? We are spiritually dead today because we rebel against the Lord. We are spiritually dead today because we rebel against the Lord. Lamentation 2:13. What thing shall I take to witness for thee? That thing shall I liken unto thee. I mean, what thing shall I liken unto thee, O daughter of Jerusalem? What shall I equal to thee that I may comfort thee, O virgin daughter of Zion? For thy breach is great like the sea. Who can heal thee? So the question is the breach. What's the breach? You know, a breach is when you put up sandbags to keep water out from your house. But now the water has broken through. So that's a breach. That's a protection. It's broken. Verse 14, thy prophets have seen vain and foolish things for thee, and they have not discovered thine iniquity to turn away thy captivity, but have seen for thee false burdens and causes of banishment. It says, thy prophets have seen vain and foolish things for thee, and they have not discovered thine iniquity to turn away thy captivity. So, hold on a minute. To turn away thy captivity. So these pastors, these reverends, these ministers are supposed to be teaching our people the law, the commandments. So we can keep the laws and commandments to turn back, to turn away our captivity. But they have not done that. This is scripture. Hold on a minute, y'all. Isaiah 28 and 14. I'm going to start there. Isaiah 28 and 14. It says, wherefore, hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men that rule this people, which is in Jerusalem. Who are the scornful men? Your leaders, your pastors, your reverends. Those are the scornful men. Verse 15, because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell are we at agreement. So these leaders, especially religious leaders, have made a covenant with death, an agreement with death. And at hell are they at agreement. What's the hell that they are at agreement? Our captivity. Our slavery. So they made an agreement with Esau. I'll say Esau. To keep us in slavery. Keep us in the conditions that we are in today. It says, when the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall come, it shall not come to us. That's what the preachers say, the leaders say. For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves. So, if you are in Christianity, any Christian church, leave. Because they are not warning you, they're not correcting you, they're not teaching you, number one, who your God is, who you are, and what does God require of us. They're not doing that. Because if they were, we would repent and keep the commandments of God. But our religious leaders tell us that the law has been done away with. And our people continually go to these whorehouses, as the Bible calls them, whorehouses, continually go to these whorehouses and get put to sleep. Our people are being led to the slaughter. Go back to Lamentations 2 and 14. Lamentations 2 and 14. Thy prophets have seen vain and foolish things for thee, and they have not discovered thine iniquity to turn away thy captivity, but have seen for thee false burdens and causes of banishment. Those false burdens are New Year's Eve, birthdays, Father's Day, Mother's Day, Christmas, Easter, Thanksgiving. Those are false burdens which cause us to be banished from the kingdom. Verse 15, all that pass by clap their hands at thee. They hiss and wag their head at the daughter of Jerusalem, saying, is this the city that men call the perfection of beauty, the joy of the whole earth? So now these other nations are shaking their head like, this is our people, God? Is this the great nation? These people sagging their pants, smoking weed. This people. Lord help us. We are in the middle of a 31-day camp. And we go out to teach our people in Sin City. We in Lamentations now, sis. Yes, we in Lamentations now. And the condition that our people are in is, it piss you off. Yeah, the heathens are mocking us. Yes. This is our conditions today. And the way our people act, the way they dress, our sisters, Lord have mercy. Yo, look, if you're 300 pounds, don't wear tight, well, you shouldn't be wearing tight clothes anyway, but our sisters wear the tightest clothes, fishnet. I'm gonna spare you some of the things that we see. Lord have mercy. If you don't come to Vegas, you won't believe it until you see it. Here's an example. Captain Joel came to Vegas, I think it was last year. I think it was last year. And there was this sister, not in the truth. And he asked, "Is that a prostitute?" That's what he asked. "Is that a prostitute?" By the way she was dressed. And we said, "No, Cap, that's a regular woman." But that's the way they dress out here. That's the way they dress. Verse 15 again. All that passed by clapped their hands at thee. They hissed and wagged their head at the daughter of Jerusalem, saying, "Is this the city that men call the perfection of beauty, the joy of the whole earth?" Verse 16, "All thine enemies have opened their mouth against thee. They hiss and gnash the teeth. They say, we have swallowed her up. Certainly, this is the day that we looked for. We have found, we have seen it." Wow, this is the day that they have looked for. This is the day that they have looked for. They've been waiting for this. And look at where we are now. The men, the males, I'll say males, look like gremlins. That movie Gremlins was made about our people. The males and the females look like gremlins. Go to Lamentations 4 and verse 1. Lamentations 4 and 1. Oh, wow. Y'all set up your prayers for us because Lord have mercy. We have a lot of our people are bugged out. They're just bugged out. They want to fight us. They want to curse us out. So set up prayers that the Lord send his holy angels around us to protect us. And another thing too, in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of a pandemic. Lamentations 4 and 1. How is the gold become dim? How is the most fine gold changed? The stones of the sanctuary are poured out in the top of every street. I'm gonna see if y'all catch it. What do you catch with this scripture? I'm gonna read it again. How is the gold become dim? How is the most fine gold changed? The stones of the sanctuary are poured out in the top of every street. Who caught it? Who caught it? That's a good point. Since my brother went to Sin City and he said the only thing you get in trouble for is jaywalking. Isn't that incredible? You can sin. It's not so true anymore. But you'll get a ticket for jaywalking. You got a blunt in your hand. You got alcohol in your hand. But jaywalking, they give you a ticket. All right. The Israelite man is a goal being dimmed, doing wickedness in the streets. Wow. Yes. It says, how is the gold become dim? How is the most fine gold changed? The stones of the sanctuary are poured out in the top of every street. So we went from gold, changed to stones. So we're no longer shining as fine gold of Ophir. Verse 2, the precious sons of Zion, comparable to fine gold, how are they esteemed as earthen pitchers, the work of the hands of the potter? So we went from gold to stones to now pitchers, clay. Clay. Wow. The only way to change gold is to add impurities. And those impurities are sin. Or sin. Let's see something. Go to Ecclesiastes 4:1. Ecclesiastes 4:1. Ecclesiastes 4:1. So I returned and considered all the oppressions that are done under the sun, and behold the tears of such as were oppressed, and they had no comforter. And on the side of their oppressors, there was power, but they had no comforter. This is the state of our people right now, the oppression of our people. Verse 2, wherefore I praise the dead which are already dead more than the living which are yet alive. Wow. I'm going to read that again. Wherefore I praise the dead which are already dead more than the living which are yet alive. He's saying, you know what? It's better to be dead than to be alive and in the state that our people are in. Verse 3, yea, better is he than both they which hath not yet been, who hath not seen the evil work that is done under the sun. Wow. So it's better that we were, if we were dead and buried, than to be alive and in this condition. That's where we're at right now. Go to Jeremiah 17 and 4. Jeremiah 17 and verse 4. Jeremiah 17 and 4. And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee. What is our heritage? It says, we will discontinue from our heritage that I gave thee. What is our heritage? Let's go to Sirach 17 and 11. Sirach 17 and 11. Besides this, he gave them knowledge and the law of life for an heritage. That's our heritage, the laws of God. Let's see what else is our heritage. First Maccabees 12 and 9. 1 Maccabees 12 and 9. Therefore we also, albeit we need none of these things, for that we have the holy books of Scripture in our hands to comfort us. Oh, read that again. Therefore we also, albeit we need none of these things, for that we have the holy books of Scripture in our hands to comfort us. We have the Scriptures in our hands to comfort us. The Bible was given to us. That is our heritage. The Bible is our heritage. 2 Maccabees 2 and 17. 2 Maccabees 2 and 17. So we're going over to the scriptures of what our heritage is. First and foremost, it's the laws of God. It's the Bible, the scriptures. 2 Maccabees 2:17. We hope also that the God that delivered all his people and gave them all an heritage and the kingdom and the priesthood and the sanctuary. That is also our heritage. I'm going to read it one more time. We hope also that the God that delivered all his people and gave them all an heritage and the kingdom and the priesthood and the sanctuary. You all realize that the kingdom, that's our heritage. The priesthood is our heritage. The sanctuary is our heritage. Go back to Jeremiah 17 and 4. Jeremiah 17 and verse 4. And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee, that the Lord gave us. And I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not, for ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever. Wow, 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 wow. So, and we thought some of my people just think our heritage is our nationality. No, it's a lot more than that. Very good, Brother Oduda. Yes, that's correct. That is correct. Hold on. Let's go to Romans, since that brother brought that up. Let's go to Romans. Let's go to the New Testament, because Rev says that the Old Testament has been done away with. Okay. Romans 3 and 1. Romans 3 and 1. What advantage then hath the Jew, or what profit is there in circumcision? Much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. We just read that in 2 Maccabees 2:17. Because unto them, chiefly, mainly, because the words of God were given to the Israelites. Let's get more. Let's get more. Acts 10 and verse 36. Acts 10 and 36. Let's see if anything changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Let's see if anything changed. We just read Romans 3, 1 and 2. This is Acts chapter 10, verse 36. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel. I'm confused now. Because Rev says that the Bible's for everybody, God loves everybody, the word is for everybody. But here the Bible says the word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace. By Jesus Christ, He is Lord of all the Israelites. Verse 37, that word I say ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. We were in Romans. Third chapter, first and second verse. I'll read it again. If I'm going too fast, y'all let me know, because I get on a roll. Romans 3 and 1 again. What advantage then hath the Jew, or what profit is there in circumcision? Verse 2. Much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. Yeah, Facebook is the devil. I don't know if I'm seeing all your comments. Hold on a minute. How is the videos, the sound in the video right now? So I can never tell. Is everything good? How is everything? Okay, all right, all right. Okay, all praises. All right, yeah, now I see you. Okay, back to the lesson. Let's go to Ezekiel 37 and 1. Ezekiel 37 and 1. Ezekiel 37 and 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones. Why is a valley full of bones? Why is the valley full of bones? What do the bones represent? The valley is full of bones. What do those bones represent? So this valley is full of bones. Very good, very good. Yes. Yes. Hold this. We're going to go to Revelation 11 and 8. Revelation 11th chapter and the 8th verse. Full of bones. Very good, very good. It's not just the ghetto. It's not just the ghetto. Yeah, that's part of it. That's part of it. Revelation 11 and 8. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. So those bones represent our dead bodies because mainly we're spiritually dead, and of course, we're getting killed here in America, mainly across the earth, but spiritually, this is Sodom and Egypt. Let's go back to Ezekiel, chapter 37 and verse 11. Ezekiel 37 and verse 11. Ezekiel 37, verse 11. Then he said unto me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried and our hope is lost. We are cut off for our parts. Back to first verse. Back to the first verse. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones. Let's go to Proverbs 21 and 16. Proverbs 21 and 16. The man that wandereth out the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. The congregation of the dead. Our people are not keeping the commandments of God. They wandered off the knowledge and understanding. So they are dead, spiritually dead. Y'all do realize that the zombie movies are made about our people. Because we're spiritually dead. Back to Ezekiel 37 and verse 9 now. Ezekiel 37 and verse 9. We've been through Ezekiel 37 chapter many, many, many times. When you get a chance, read the 37th chapter of Ezekiel. I'm just gonna go through a few scriptures in Ezekiel. Ezekiel 37 and 9. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain that they may live. Breathe on the slain. Hold this. Isaiah 55 and verse 11. Isaiah 55 and verse 11. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Breathe on the slain. Prophesy unto them the Lord's word, God's word. To the slain, to the spiritually dead Israelites. Back to Ezekiel 37 and 9. Ezekiel 37 and 9. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe unto the slain that they may live. Verse 10. So I prophesied as he had commanded me, as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood up upon their feet an exceeding great army. We are commanded to go to our people and teach them the word of God, the laws, statutes, and commandments of God. This is commanded by God. So when we go out and teach, we teach our people the commandments of God, the laws of God, so that they may live. Verse 10 again. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. So what you're seeing today is our people starting to wake up. They're being revived. They're being revived. The great revival is not that Christianity garbage. The revival is the Israelites waking up, coming back to life. That's the revival. Not what that was Christianity pushes, that garbage. A bunch of Negroes and Hispanics and Native Americans go in his tent, underneath his tent, and start so-called speaking in tongues. That's no. That's not the revival that the Bible's talking about. And do you know, what does it take for mainly our men to go on the street and teach our people the laws of God? What does it take to do that? I'm gonna see if you're thinking. What does it take to do that? They are being revived in real time, right in front of our eyes. Yeah, but what does it take for our men to go and teach our people? Is there something? If I make this other comment, I'm gonna give it to y'all. What does it take? There it goes. Officer Elijah. Yes. It takes courage. Courage. To go teach our people, as rebellious as they are. But it takes courage. It also takes obedience. Well, yeah, it takes courage. You know, why aren't the reverends out on the street teaching the people? Why aren't they doing that? Yes. Very good. Because what happens when the nations see our men in order? What happens? What happens When the nations see our men in order, Yes, indeed. So you mean to tell me that they see the purple and gold in order? And they're afraid of that? So they're not afraid of a bunch of Negroes with guns? They're not afraid of that, but they are afraid when they see us in order. So the Negro that has carrying all these weapons, the nation's not fearing that. But when they see it's in order, they fear that. Give me wisdom of Solomon 5:1. Wisdom of Solomon 5:1. No, that's fear. Fear falls on them. Fear. Fear. This singer, this Israelite brother, what's his name? Gil Scott-Heron. Gil Scott-Heron said the revolution will not be televised. You don't see us on TV. But there's a revolution going on. And it doesn't involve guns. It involves the scriptures. That's the weapon. Wisdom of Solomon 5:1. Then shall the righteous man stand in great boldness before the face of such as have afflicted him and made no account of his labors. When they see it, they shall be troubled with terrible fear, and shall be amazed at the strangeness of his salvation, so far beyond all that they looked for. That's the fear. That is the fear. Watch this. Hold on a minute. Hold on a minute. Let's go to Hebrews. Hebrews. Go to Hebrews 4:12. Hebrews 4:12. Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So the word of God is more powerful than any weapon. Any weapon. More powerful than a two-edged sword, More powerful than AK, whatever, with a more powerful than AR, whatever. This Bible. This Bible. Wow. Hold on. Now it just something just came in my thought. Hold on a minute. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 4 and 9. First Corinthians 4 and 9. First Corinthians 4:9. For I think that God has set forth his us. I'm reading again. For I think that God has set forth us, the apostles, last, as it were appointed to death. For we are made a spectacle unto the world, and to angels, and to men. Verse 10. We are fools for Christ's sake. But ye are wise in Christ. We are weak, but ye are strong. Ye are honorable, but we are despised. This is for I think, verse 9 again, for I think that God has set forth us, the apostles, last. Why does it say that? Let's see. We have several movements among our people. We had the civil rights movement, dominated mainly by Christianity. Guess what? Our people are finding out it doesn't work. It doesn't work because our people, a great my grandma, our grandma, our mothers are in Christianity, and guess what? We're still in hell. Nothing has changed. It's gotten worse. Then is the Nation of Islam. They have their time. They had their time. That doesn't work either. People are finding this out. The Lord's a mastermind. So he says, for I think that God has set forth us, the apostles, last. Our people are looking for solutions now. Voting doesn't solve anything, that's for sure. Oh, okay. So I'm going to choose between two devils. Devil number one that's already in office, devil number two that's trying to get in office. Devil number one says, I don't like you niggas. But I'm going to do certain things to so you get the illusion that you are included. Devil number two, a long time KKK supporting racist. But I'm gonna take I'm gonna do just photo ops with you Negroes. So you Negroes can be deceived. Y'all see the foolishness? Are y'all paying attention? Are y'all paying attention? When the only solution is the black Messiah as our king, the black Messiah, Jesus the Christ. And keeping his commandments. So I'm a, these woke Woke Negroes are not woke. They still sleep. Because you're still voting. You're still voting. You still sleep. You're still dead. If you're voting, you're dead. If you're voting, you're dead. We have some of our leaders keep pushing, vote, 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 vote. Vote Democrat, 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 Democrat. Then you have the other Negroes. Vote Republican, 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 Republican. Neither one is going to change anything. It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse. But the only solution is keeping God's commandments and the faith of Christ as Israelites. As Israelites. Hold on. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 1. And 24. 1 Corinthians 1 and 24. I'll say this. Okay, in Chicago, when we had over 1,000 men marching, and I was at the end, the rear of the march, because my feet are afflicted. And I was there with his brother, if I remember his name. If I can remember his name, I think he's from Memphis. Moses, Moses, that's his name. And he said, you know, you realize that we are a walking flyer? So we are a walking flyer, walking billboards for Christ. I remember, that brother Moses. In Atlanta, all praise to the Most High, we marched again. But this time, I was determined, I'm going to finish this thing. I'm not going to be in the back. No. Yeah, I was in pain. Yeah, I was jacked up. But guess what? Through the Spirit of the Lord, I finished that march. I finished the one in Chicago too, but wasn't in the back. But let's get to the scriptures. 1 Corinthians 1:24. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men. And the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. So so-called scholars, are they in the truth? Preaching the gospel? No. Not many mighty are most of our athletes in the truth. I say most because some are, but most of them not. Not many noble are called. No. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound things which are mighty. So you mean to tell me these minimum wage brothers, God called? They used to be thugs and drug dealers and gang members, God called them? Weak things of the world to confound the mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised, which God chose, hath God chosen, yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. That no flesh should glory in his presence, but of him that are in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. That according as it is written, he that glorifieth, let him glory in the Lord. So in all things, God gets the glory. This shows the power that he has through these scriptures. Let's go to Hosea 6 and 1. Hosea 6 and 1. Hosea 6 and 1. It says, come and let us return unto the Lord, for he hath torn and he will heal us. He hath smitten and he will bind us up. Verse 2, after 2 days will he revive us. In the third day, he will raise us up and we shall live in his sight. Verse 2 again. After 2 days will he revive us. In the third day will he raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Hold on a minute. Let's go to, we're coming back to Hosea. Let's go to Malachi 4th chapter and the 5th verse. Malachi 4th chapter, 5th verse. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. So Elijah the prophet has already come. We don't know who he is. We can speculate, but he's already come. Right? As I'm going to read 5 again. And behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. That coming and dreadful day is when Christ returns and drops those nuclear bombs with his angels. That's a great and dreadful day. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children. What's the heart of the fathers? The Bible. To who's the children? The Israelites. And the heart of the children to their fathers. The Bible, our forefathers in the scriptures. Lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Let's go back to Hosea 6 and 2. Hosea 6 and 2. And after 2 days will he revive us. In the third day, he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Let's go to 2 Peter 3 and 8. Second Peter 3:8. Second Peter 3:8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years is as one day. I'm sorry, a thousand years as one day. Let me read it again. But beloved, be not ignorant for this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day. Who caught it? No. No. Who caught it? Wow, man, oh man. Okay. I'm gonna read 2 Peter 3:8 again. Second Peter 3:8. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day. I'm going back to Hosea 6:2. Hosea 6:2. After 2 days will he revive us. In the third day he will raise us up, and he and we shall live in his sight. Verse 3, then shall we know, if we follow on to know the Lord, his going forth is prepared as the morning, and he shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth. On a minute, y'all. I'll find the scripture. Let's go to Psalms 30th chapter. I'm going to start at verse 2. Psalms 30:2. The book of Psalms, chapter 30, verse 2. O Lord my God, I cried unto thee, and thou hast healed me. O Lord, thou hast brought up my soul from the grave. Thou hast kept me alive, that I should not go down to the pit. Sing unto the Lord, O ye saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness. For his anger endureth but a moment, and his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Wow. Verse 5 again. For his anger endureth but for a moment. His anger endureth but a moment. So, to the Lord, it's a moment. To us, it seems like eternity. But to the Lord, it's a moment. And his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Who caught it? Who got it? If you don't, meditate. Hang on. Endure to the end. I gotta read Hosea again. Hosea 6 and 2. Hosea 6 and 2. For 2 days will he revive us. After 2 days will he revive us. And the third day he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning, and he shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth. Endure to the end. We almost there. We're almost there. Just endure to the end. Last scripture. Matthew 24 and 13. Matthew 24 and 13. Brother Adam. Matthew 24:13. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. The same shall be saved. Endure, Israel. Hold the line. Stay the course. Be unmovable. We almost home. Y'all realize that? Don't bug out now. It's the wrong time to bug out. We're almost home, y'all. And that's a class. Any questions pertaining to class? Any questions pertaining to class? Don't get distracted. Stay focused. Stay focused. That's right. Stay in the spirit and endure. Study, pray, and apply. Yes. You realize it's a slogan, but it's so true. Study, pray, and apply. Study, pray, and apply. You realize when Jesus was tempted by the devil, Christ stayed in the scriptures. Christ stayed in the scriptures. When the scripture says on that third day he will raise us up, is that meaning we will rule with Christ for 1,000 years? Lord's will. Lord's will. But there is a. So we get delivered out of Babylon the Great. We get delivered from where we are scattered all over the earth. And there is a stopping point, a proving point, before we get the kingdom. Right now, don't get distracted. There's too many doctrines out there. There's too many things to get caught up in that will distract you from the truth. They will distract you from the truth. Don't get distracted. Stay focused. And when you study, you pray, you apply, you are focused on the mission at hand. You are focused. I've seen so many of our people who know they're Israel bug out in all these doctrines. Salam, a young king who knows he's Israel now wants to keep his kids away from his heathen mother. What does the Bible say? Hold on. Exodus 20 and 12. Exodus 20 and 12. We'll start there. It says, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. So we are told to honor our father and mother. Not to disrespect them, even if they are heathen, still keep the commandments of God. But don't, if she tells them to sin, break God's commandments, don't listen to that. But if they are in her house, they are under her authority. All right? But we are supposed to honor our father and mother. No, don't curse them out. Nope, nope. Nope, don't do that. Nope. Honor them as they are, keep the commandments of God. But, of course, God doesn't honor the heathen keeping the commandments, but we still respect and honor them. All right? All right. No more questions. Donate to the Booster Club. Don't forget to donate to the Booster Club. Brother Adam, thank you for scribing. All praises, Lord, to the Lord. Thank you, brother. All right. Don't forget to send up prayers for the leadership, that the Lord will continue to build them up, guide them, to lead us into righteousness. Let's send up the prayers for all Israel, that they may repent and keep the commandments of God and faith of Christ. All right. Hang on, Israel. We're almost home. And that could be another, we don't know when Christ is returning. No, we don't know. No. All right, y'all. And with that, say shalom. Most High Christ bless. Love y'all.